Hi, I'm Jason. Thanks for having me again. This is not my first time here. I've wanted to come back to this place for a long time. I've already told my students this, so I'll keep it short this time. But every time I come here, I like it. For a long time, I wanted to come here for an extended visit. I finally got the opportunity. I'm very, very grateful to everybody who has allowed that to happen. So thanks, Ohio State, for that. Let me just get into it. I've gotten into the habit recently of giving a brief kind of introduction that I think generally situates my thinking. I often characterize it as a kind of generational thinking. I don't know if that's so true. I don't know if my colleagues in my generation would even agree, but that's what I do. So I'll do that first, and then I'll get into the work. Oh, sorry. Let me turn the mic on. How's that sound? Is that better? No? Better?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. Perfect. So some of you who know me are aware that for a good number of years now, the idiomatic gang that I've been associated with, a lot of people call it a gang, just a group of people that I've been associated with has relied heavily on arguments to do with technique. And certain critical proponents of our work, like one guy sitting right here where I can see him, often cite Jimi Hendrix and his technical virtuosity as proof positive that technique itself can go a long, long way toward creating great form. I totally agree, Jeff, totally agree. So it's gonna sound like I'm gonna start to disagree, but that's not what's happening. not that stupid. For us, this reference to Hendrix has become ubiquitous. So uncontested as to have become part of our collective subconscious. In fact, later in a project you'll see that Heather and I did together, we actually name it after a Hendrix song. So it's as ubiquitous in my thinking as it is in anyone else's. Now we all know the brilliance of Hendrix's radical technique, but I like to show this clip anyway just to bring the point home. Let's let this play for maybe a minute and I won't talk over Jimmy. You guys know that he's left-handed, right? Everybody knows that? And everybody knows it's a right-handed guitar and he's got it upside down. Okay. Notice, by the way, the camera work, whoever's running the camera does a lot of this kind of thing, close-ups of the playing, of the technique, and also is very respectfully still when we're backed up and can see Hendrix in full. So for a long time, I think we were satisfied with this model for practice. By the way, I'm a guy who loves to bring in outside models, extra disciplinary models into architectural practice. I think that it's always a very kind of it's a way to fertilize what we do. Anyway, Hendrix has been the kind of technique hero, I think, for a lot of us. And you might ask, what comes after? I think David Bowie comes after. Let's look at this for a few minutes. Or really, just for about a minute. And try to, in your head, do a compare and contrast between what you just saw and what you're seeing now. Thank you. always the close-ups are on the face, on the character of Ziggy. Jimmy played guitar, that's for sure, but Ziggy played guitar too. And what I want to describe is how Ziggy did it entirely differently. I want to move the argument from Hendrix to Bowie, from technique to performance, from device to objective, from instruments to instrumentality. Some things to notice and compare between the two things we just saw, the two performances. The word play means two very different things with these two performers. Play with Hendrix refers to what he's doing with the instrument and with his hands on the instrument. Play with Bowie refers to how he's assumed the role of guitar player. Notice there's no guitar with Ziggy. He's assumed the role of guitar player only to be able to move beyond that to the larger performance, the greater theater of it all. Notice that Hendrix is actually playing a guitar, and I mentioned about how the camera often focuses on his playing technique. In contrast, notice that Bowie doesn't even have one. His hands and body are then free to do other things, to assume the flamboyant gesticulations and posturing of this character he's created, this project that he's created, called Ziggy Stardust. And then I'll go on a little bit further on this, just to unpack it. Let's listen to what Ziggy has to say about how he played guitar. We just heard it, but I'll play these cuts. See if I've got them. No, I don't. Sorry. I've taken that sound out. But I can quote. Ziggy played guitar, jamming good with Weird and Gilly and the Spiders from Mars. He played it left hand. Here he's talking about playing guitar as the creation of a theater troupe, Weird and Gilly and the Spiders from Mars. Plus, he played it left hand, which is a reference to playing it wrong, purposely playing it wrong. Another thing he says in that song, Ziggy really sang, screwed up eyes and screwed down hairdo, like some cat from Japan. He could lick him by smiling, he could leave him to hang. They came on so loaded, man, well hung and snow white tan. Here he seems to be equating singing with his look. It's a more expansive understanding of this, this act or this performance than one that's merely technical. Third, he was the Naz with God-given ass. He took it all too far, but boy, could he play guitar. And so here he brags about his guitar playing in the same space as the description of his physique. So you see, and he doesn't even have a guitar. So clearly it's a more expansive understanding of the notion of what guitar playing even means. I think that in all of this, Bowie fleshes out a larger agenda for the project of playing the guitar. The great lesson of Bowie is that the instrument itself isn't enough. Rather, it's the larger performance that matters. We've got to sublimate our expertise to larger objectives. That's where I'm going with this talk tonight. And I've tried to organize the projects that I'll show today to illustrate this move from instrument to instrumentality. Now, the other thing by way of introduction is much more personal to me, which is to say this strange subject that's become associated, for better or for worse, with my own work, which is hair. The question is, what about this? What is that all about, is what I've been asked in the past. And so I want to kind of get it out of the way right in the beginning, and then we'll talk about how it plays into the work all throughout. First, for me, hair has been a device in which its instrumentality has changed over time. So I am interested in hair, but I'm not interested in hair any more than I might be interested in other extra disciplinary subjects like botany, for example, or anything else you might think of, things that you're probably interested in. It's a device for me that operates in a variety of ways and allows me to talk about certain design issues from a different perspective than one might normally take. By device, I mean a tool of sorts, a kind of pry bar that I've used to try to dislodge certain conventions from time to time. I say its instrumentality for me has shifted over time because the conventions that I'm trying to dislodge or move tend to change from project to project, and hopefully we'll see that. And so essentially what Payne gives me is a way to push on things or to move them in my own work. So moving from less to more architecturally relevant examples, from the esoteric to the practical, I hope to show that in the work how hair acts as an instrumental device. Because I found that it's been able to do more than simply get people's attention. It really can do work on some of the more fundamental problems of architecture, problems like surface, legibility, figuration, atmosphere, and believe it or not, even program and function at times. Okay, so the work. Let's go back in history. I won't linger long on this project. This is actually a student project. I think it's normally advised not to do this in a lecture when you're no longer a student, but this is really where the interest in some of the issues of hair were born for me, and it was when I was a student. I entered a competition, and our friend Carl Chu, was overseeing this as I did these drawings. And basically, I was what you'll see the next five or so slides are images of an extended kind of drawing meditation, not unlike the way I would imagine Danielle Libeskind might have thought of the chamber works. I'm not certain of that, but that's the way I tend to imagine this. It doesn't amount to an architectural proposal. Rather, it is just, in some sense, just a kind of drafting exercise, if you will. And the subject of it was a thing called cellular automata. That doesn't really matter so much for us, I think, tonight. But that's a thing that doesn't, CAs are systems that come from complexity theory and the complexity sciences, and they're things that don't have a geometry associated with them. So the general point with this work was to see if I could invent a geometry that might attach itself to a cellular automata. It's an early attempt to push through pure topology into a realm of geometry that's somehow more than single surfaces. The later work really gets into that a whole lot, but it started here. And my first intuition here was to create the linear framework for manifold surfaces, or multiple surfaces. To take this and loft a more compound surficial massing. It ultimately didn't work what I was trying to do with the topology. I wanted to actually make surfaces. I never do with this project. Instead, what I became interested in with this was the look and the feel of the piles of the delicate lines that started to gather in the field. This is what a CA often looks like when you start it. There's no geometry attached. It's just a rule-based system where if there's a gray one on top and a blue one on the bottom, it sort of makes another gray one to the right. And it just sort of kind of grows automatically according to a simple rule-based system. The first move was to invent a kind of notational device that would track the growth of this system, and that drawing looked like this. This was that drawing, a kind of hand drawing that's mostly notation. And from that then, a kind of curvilinear aesthetic was attached to that notational system, such that I could actually start to draft a drawing on a piece of paper, a piece of mylar. And so that's what that started to look like. Later on, this is the first time I ever worked with Heather Oberge, an esteemed graduate from your school, and was my partner in Newform for several years. This was based on those earlier drawings, and these are a series of particle animations to try to capture the same sort of behaviors and really expand the aesthetic of that line work from hundreds of lines to thousands or even tens of thousands of lines. Anyway, back to those early drawings, looking at some of that line work close up, far away, and developing, let's say, more detail scaled, making more detail scaled aesthetic decisions about the curvilinearity. And ultimately, that combined with those digital animations that I just showed you, the particle animations, led to Heather and I producing a set of principles. So for me personally, I think what came out of that work was a belief in the potential for piles of lines that go on to become hair at some point later. I think for both Heather and I, what came out of it, a secondary thing that came out of it was a series of operational principles that often are associated with positive lines. And this was some of those. It's a kind of manual of sorts for working on things with lots of particles or lots of lines. Anyway, then we go on to some work. And the next few projects, I think, are from New Forms. So this was me and Heather working together. First one is the Queen's Museum of Art Expansion Strategy of 2001. I think ultimately Eric Moss won this project. Now what's happened? This is just an image of it. Now notice that even though I'm moving to a more conventional architectural project out of those particle animations, those particle animations came just before we embarked on this project. So even though we're moving into a kind of more conventional architectural proposal here, there remains this imperative to express line work, geometry, and so on, to express the instruments used to generate the work itself. So it's got there's like this imperative in the work early on that you hopefully see evaporating toward the end, that the tool had to show up in the work itself. And so we made sure that the geometries and the tectonics that we were using in these projects kind of expressed, not quite literally, but almost, these kinds of geometries that we were using to produce the surfaces in the first place. So the project's diagram is relatively simple. It's a bowl that's suspended in the existing box of the Queen's Museum. You'll see it in a minute. We keep most of the queens and then we put a new thing inside. The underside of the bowl becomes an interior ceiling plane that drops very close to the floor in places, which you'll see that in a minute too. Celebrating the spectacle of structure with this suspension net of posts and cables. And we thought of this suspension net as stubble on topology's otherwise smooth skin. The top side of the bowl becomes an interior public park of sorts, inspired by the simple truth that stepped surfaces like the one at the Metropolitan Museum, for example, or the one here in your school, tend to provoke informal public gathering, often better than stuff that's far more elaborate. So it's a big step surface. Here we see the diagram of the surface and its relationship to the more formal programming of the surrounding spaces. So more or less the strategy was to push all formal programming that required lots of partitions and so on to the perimeter of the building, thus opening up this big open space in between and then sort of draping that that big bowl on the inside. This is just an exploded axon showing the way those pieces come together. And the plans. And the rendering, showing the way that thing, that kind of stubbly surface kind of hangs super low to the main floor of the building. Now, out of this competition, we really enjoyed doing that competition. A lot of ideas were provoked, and some of them were more esoteric, some of them were much more building oriented. So we were sort of going in two directions out of there. And so we decided to do a series of experiments in the office that would explore some of this kind of discrete problems that we were finding and that we discovered came upon in the project. So the first little experiment, we'll see, I think, three, we called the blowfish. And all I'd say is that the blowfish met its massing study. And the blowfish massing studies came about as a result of our frustration with the sparseness of the queen's stubble, the kind of thinness of it. Someone's calling me. That's what we just talked about. I don't answer it, right? I don't know, I don't recognize the number. Anyway, we were looking for a more full kind of growth of hair with blowfish. So it was this little model that wound up getting coated in nickel that was like this, where we explored the top geometry and the underside geometry differently, and we sort of intentionally made it a lot more fat. Maybe this is actually, for my students, something like we were talking about with alligators today, this weird dead skin on top. So that's what that looked like. Now, much more substantial experiment that came out of that work was this thing that we called the octopus. This time the ambition was toward a more full or comprehensive or realistic tectonic expression that plays out in further material differentiation and a variety of more subtle operations on the surface morphology of the tiled belly. Basically the point here was we really would have loved to have seen that project win and get built, and we wanted to know if you really could build a surface like that. If you did, of course you can build anything, so if you did, how would you actually build that? You see the impulse here to move away from simple topology and single surfaces that are the same on both sides through the development of the necessarily different structural systems of the top and the bottom of that bowl. So we're not, by the way, not working on the whole building anymore, we're just working on that bowl surface. And we took it to Arup in Los Angeles, people who are schooled in engineering know this is an awful surface. They were laughing at us when they ran the analysis on that surface we had done and came back to tell us just how profoundly inefficient it was. I think we kind of knew that it would be. But anyway, the point here was to see if, you know, how would an engineer a thing so that it would stand up. So they did that. This was their model for how the thing would actually, you know, be constructed structurally. So as you see, it actually can't float on the rim of the existing building like we said it would. It would get tied back to the ground outside. These are just more studies. And then these puckers you see were taken from the blowfish exercise. It's an attempt to suggest something sort of hairy without doing hair. That's kind of important because for a long time, and I'm going to show you the precise moment where I at least became comfortable with doing hair literally in architecture. But for a long time, she and I were very against that, which is why all this stuff skirts around it and always is trying to make hair, but it's not hair, it's actually serious architecture. Make the set of principles and all the rest of it. Ultimately, I think I give in. I think she's continues to fight the good fight. I think I probably took the easy route. Anyway, model details. Here it is in the context of the stuff we had to produce to make those plastic tiles. This will get interesting later. Here it is in context of something I did much later, the raspberry fields. It's also in the context, I like it better in the context of some of my friends' work. That red one is Florencia Pita, who is lecturing later, so I guess you'll see the red one. And then Michael Meredith, who's a good friend of mine, did my other favorite piece in the show, though I shouldn't have said that publicly. But he did a black rubber furry carpet. Huh?
They're calling me publicly.
Oh, did I just call you publicly? Anyway, and then Iwamoto Scott's thing, which is very cool.
Have you seen Michael's piece of Wex?
I have, and I like it.
Sorry.
That's okay. Hair comes in all different forms and shapes and sizes. Nobody owns hair. Anyway, a close-up of the thing. And the Man of War, which comes up in a minute, is behind this in relation to Man of War. The High Line, this is not one of those experiments. I'll go through this fast. This is just to assure you that when I say Heather and I, we're trying to take this stuff seriously and trying to do real architecture, I mean it, and we even went so far as to try to do urban planning. And so we entered the High Line competition, which everyone here is very aware of what that was and is. And the basic premise here, this came right after the Queen's Museum for us, was to imagine the High Line as a series of micro greenhouses, each containing a different ecology of exotic plant life with an excessive amount of pedestrian connection to the streets below, to encourage less linear circulation along the length of the existing High Line structure. So that's just a close-up of one of the drawings. And some of the elements that were part of that thing. Now the idea for the exotic enclosed greenhouses was an attempt to compete with the power of more well-known open field parks in New York City, such as Central Park and the New York Botanical Garden. Here's our idea. If you imagine taking one of those and squeezing it to fit along the length of the High Line, conceptually, you get a kind of extreme condensation, a form of species of occupation. And so, for example, rarefied plant species that we were proposing to go in these greenhouses, those are imagined to be the condensed version of more typical sprawling plants that you might find in the more conventional open park. And the hot humidity of the greenhouses, which comes up again later in PS1, the hot humidity of the greenhouses is imagined to be a similar kind of atmospheric condensation. So if you squeezed all the air in this room close, I think you get condensation. So this becomes important later in our PS1, I just said that. Here's diagrams showing a kind of idea about how I think the Central Park can be understood as bounded by the city or captured by the city. And in ours, with the High Line, it sort of naturally extends or captures the city. And there was also an idea about phasing. Part of the reason we chose to pursue it in the way we did was that you could do it one or two greenhouses at a time, so there's a sort of feasibility aspect to the whole thing. Okay, now so back to the last of the three experiments, the man of war. We move here to the first example of hair being taken very literally, though this is not the first time I felt comfortable with it. I still wasn't totally comfortable. It's important to note the context for this project was a gallery installation rather than it being understood more conventionally as an architectural proposal. That's why I could feel comfortable with it at this point. In our new form office statement, we had this line that more or less sums up one of the most fundamental objectives of that practice, which was to make architecture that clings to the skin of the people moving through it. And so the man of war was meant to simply be the clearest expression of that idea that we could make. First, before I show you the man of war, I'll show you this clip from Night of the Hunter. It has like sound to it too, it's quiet. But like we wanted architecture at that time, we wanted to work on the atmosphere of the building, as opposed to the hard form of the building. We drew a kind of hard line distinction between those two. I don't think we do that as much anymore. But so this part of this movie and stuff like this really captured for us, you know, we almost wished that air were thicker than it really is. And again, you see that in PS1 where we tried to make, we basically turn the air into water, kind of. So the man of war, essentially imagined as a space-filling project, kind of like the water and those weeds and underwater were floating around in the woman's hair and everything. The monofilament here, it's made out of a fishing line or monofilament line. It's analogous to the water and the grasses that you just saw in the Night of the Hunter. There's, I can't remember anymore, 17,900 and something individual strands of monofilament. And there are, I think, four or five different colors. Clumped into clumps, there's like 10, 15 strings hanging from each point. Another thing that's going on here is that I had long been fascinated with Gaudí's catenary models, which I would make a distinction between his models and his buildings that are based on those models. The models, for those of you who have seen them, it even shows up in the photographs, or if you go and you see them in Barcelona, it becomes really clear. They do what he says they do. They do what an engineer says they do, which is that they produce this catenary structure. So they're engineering models, that's true. But I always noticed that they threw off a kind of atmosphere. They glow, they have color, they have weight, they're very visceral. These models that he made, and I always loved that about them. I like, frankly, that more than the engineering aspect of them. And I always wanted to make, but I think it was accidental with Gaudí, and so I always wanted to make a catenary model where that aspect was foregrounded and it wasn't accidental. So that's what this is. It actually is a catenary model, but frankly, I'm not interested in the catenary aspects of it. And then what this is a plan drawing of the thing. The other thing going on with that, this is in your school, this was here. It was beautiful when it was at this school. The other thing going on with this project was back then we were more concerned with this digital design versus not digital design kind of discourse that is largely meaningless, I think, at this point. But back then so part of this project was, okay, if you make a thing that's got a material manifestation that's complex and you also have software that's capable of simulating that, how close can you get those two things to being? And when you get them as close as you can, does being able to measure the difference help? That was another question that went on with this project. I don't do that so much anymore, but I do think it's really important for students to think that way when they're digitally modeling. So that was a digital representation. The real thing's always better, everybody knows that. So here it is in your school. More interesting points than the digital stuff to make on this was that here you see it in the low winter light. January light was actually this time of year, but maybe 7 years ago or 8 years ago, of Columbus, and you see it's cool. The color is relative. There's greens, there's yellows, there's some light blues, and there's some clears mixed throughout. Here we noticed it was nearly always a kind of cool and slightly more harsh and much more rich color. When we would bring it to, when we had it in Los Angeles a few months earlier and the sun is much higher, its warmer tones were much more obvious, and it would often actually disappear in LA. The white, clear stuff would come out. We did this video, which doesn't work in the slideshow, but where there was a storm that happened in LA with all these clouds, and the thing was changing, basically changing by the second. And it was those kind of atmospheric effects that, frankly, were much more interesting to us about the project. And the last thing that was interesting about the project was that it was very well received by people. By that I mean they smiled and they liked, they were happy with it. People sometimes would walk through it. One of the interesting things that would happen then is that depending on the kind of hair you have, you would either get tangled in it and it would become a frustrating experience or an embarrassing experience, or if you have hair kind of like mine, you can go right through it. It was actually a very pleasurable experience. It would like tickle you in really nice ways. Because we had cut the thing and we actually curled the bottoms and everything so that there would be this element of tactility. So it was like a hair sorting device. That's how I saw it. So like, depending on your hair type was how it would respond to you. Anyway, now we go on to PS1. This was in 2006. We didn't win this competition. Here what we're doing is extending the shift toward heavy atmospherics that you saw in the last project toward a more complex programmatic and organizational scheme. And this is, see, we're still quoting Hendrix at this point. And still do, frankly. The whole argument is not about that was ever wrong. It's that it needs to be added to at this point. So the important ingredients here are not the physical architectural elements, but rather the spatial atmosphere that's filled with water in this project that's mixed with a lot of people moving around. So even though we made physical architectural elements, a canopy, some seating elements, some pools, and so on, really what we were trying to design is that water from Night of the Hunter. So we saturated the physical infrastructure with basically an irrigation system that you pump water into it, and three phases of water would come out, either mist, rain, or fog. Fog coming up from those green seats, mist and rain coming down from the canopy above, and that was all kind of the, I think there's diagrams later on that show where those things are happening. So there's basically a very thick atmosphere, and then so the first ingredient that we were really interested in was all this water in the air, and the second was the people that come in, because the way that this project is always used, if you win, they have these weekly parties or raves or whatever they call it. And so there's hundreds of bodies kind of all close together. And we felt like that was the second critical element. And any of the architects was sort of tertiary or at least secondary. So here are just some drawings. I'll flip through to give you a sense of this kind of infrastructure for producing atmosphere. So there's the way fog is created. It was those little donut seats are made out of flexible PVC. The water, essentially fog heads were embedded in those and it would push fog out. Like when you go to a creep show or a haunted house or something, they've got the fog kind of coming up from the ground. I think you see the influence of the Manowar project. Those little dashed lines, we're trying to like draw rain or whatever, but it's analogous to the strands in Manowar. these are just some of the diagrams, the way the systems all fit together. And see, so we felt like we needed to draw large groups of people and represent them in similar fashion to the water and the dappled sunlight and the rest of it. The form of these things, the canopy got a little bit, I think, the general diagram of the canopy is very, very simple. It's just like squeezing a saturated sponge in your hand and you get a pinch in the middle and it flares on the two ends. I think that this section of it got maybe even more complicated than we had wanted it. That just happened by virtue of what we, us cutting holes in it and letting the flaps fall down. But nevertheless, the diagram of the canopy as well as the shape of these things are, I don't know if you noticed, but we're moving toward a kind of simplified formal sense or sensibility. They're just donuts, basically, that are pushed together, as opposed to being a more, here's what I'm trying to say. If the earlier work, Queen's Museum, for example, felt like it had to express these very complex geometries that we felt that we had mastered. Here, that impulse to express that is becoming, it's evaporating, it's being sublimated to other issues, in this case, this desire to produce a very saturated atmosphere. So I guess I would relate that idea to the notion of not feeling like we always had to have our guitar on stage all the time. This is probably about the time that I started thinking Ziggy might be a better model for me than Hendrix, or at least he's the one that I need to add to Hendrix. And then here's another one. I don't show this one too often, green medium, but it's very related to the one we just saw. It's the same sort of thing here, but now the line work is applied to a more architecturally scaled proposal for the reimagining of the gardens and landscape for the Schindler House. Schindler House is in Los Angeles, it's in West Hollywood. And the problem statement, it was a competition, invited competition, and the problem is given from the Mac Center. They're the ones who own and control the Schindler House or manage it. You know that when Schindler originally designed this project, West Hollywood was very flat, open and flat, and not a lot of development there. Now, of course, West Hollywood is one of the most densely built areas in Los Angeles, and so what used to be a project by Schindler in a landscape, a project whose scale, especially its vertical scale, was largely conditioned by the assumption that that landscape was open and would remain open. That's no longer the case. A number of years ago, a tall condominium development right on one side of the Schindler property was built, 6 or 8 stories, I think. And then a few years ago, another one on the other side. So what used to be this kind of beautiful, weirdly scaled dollhouse box in the field is now this perversely scaled dollhouse in a box. And the Schindler people don't, or the Mac Center people, really hate that because it goes against the original intentions of the architect. And so their brief was, can you please, Matt, basically, to put it really bluntly, can you please mask? They also didn't like the elevations of those two surrounding buildings. They wanted us to mask them. So the diagram is basically, you used to have that, now you have this. So how can we envision, we basically understood the Schindler landscape, which is also designed by Schindler, part of that project, as you guys know. We basically fold it up as if it's like the lining or the rafting inside of a box or something like that. So our proposal was for 2 vertical gardens, one on either side of the Schindler property that mask the 2 condominium developments on either side. Their vertical gardens are green, so they are more, they're tubes, bent tube steel wrapped in a kind of steel mesh or chain link that's then interwoven with an irrigation system, not unlike the one that you just saw in PS1, and then planted, pumped with water. And so basically the idea is what used to be this lawn that was like that, but we've sort of just folded up the lawn. And we took some of the geometry, some of the order I guess, of our vertical garden from the irrigation tie-in set by Schindler, which is why you see those things tied into the middle of the property like that. So it kind of is like that. It certainly doesn't solve the problem of Schindler's house is now in a box. In a way, it actually makes it tighter. The intention here was simply to, you know, kind of acknowledge that and try to make it into a, or turn it into something as opposed to not. A physical model of the thing, so that's what it looked like. And it kind of pulls up, again, not unlike the canopy in PS1, it pulls up sectionally this time at the either end of the house. Because it's such a tight site, actually, that you can't get around it otherwise. So here's a no good television bar and film set. We were given this commission. No good television was to be a television channel that was going to be a cable channel. It's now an online presence. They were never able to get this company on television. But anyway, it was meant to be a cable channel that does kind of slightly risque stuff, which I mentioned because it's important for the way we treated the project. They used to describe it as a cross between, I think, like classic VH1 and the Comedy Channel or something. But basically, most of their content is interviews of celebrities, mostly either rock stars or celebutants, where they would record an interview, and then they would take all the parts of the interview that on a normal station, they would cut those, like where they used the F-bomb or they said something that they wished they hadn't or whatever. They take all that stuff you'd normally throw away, and they make that's their content. So it's meant to be risque, the occasional nudity on this station or this channel, and so on. And we kind of, when we got the project for redoing their headquarters, it is an existing building in Beverly Hills. First thing we did was immersed ourselves in all the content that they had generated and to try to get in the mood and match that mood or do our own take on that mood. Part of this project was, frankly, a kind of branding for them, a kind of spatial atmospheric branding project. So we did the whole thing. It was a very low budget project, so we did that classic strategy of where we took the budget and made one moment in the project very expensive, though actually this wasn't very expensive, but more expensive, and then everything else kind of more straightforward. Most of the rest of the building is like colored carpet, mirrors, kind of discotheque design, if you want to know the truth, paint. But the bar we conceived of as a reception set. The reception area we conceived of as something that would be much more central to the headquarters. And we proposed that they take what would normally be a reception area with someone answering phones, turn it into a real working bar serving alcohol that was atmospherically like a bar somehow, to sort of turn the notion of reception on its head or at least intensify it. And they loved that idea because they were different clients. They were really good clients, very different. Allowed us to do some strange things. And so that's where this NGTV bar component of the headquarters comes from. We kind of had this attitude that we would treat it like an opium den. But what we do first is that for the form of the bar, and it's pretty obvious in the form of the bar, that we looked at the morphology of the poppy flower and pod, going so far as to get a hold of the real thing. We got real kind of opium poppy pods and we dissected them, scanned them, drew them. So if you look closely at the bar, you see it's pretty close in section, as well as the color of the bar comes from the classic opium poppy. But we also took just as seriously the sociocultural material that's associated with the opium poppy, and we applied this to the overall ambiance of the space. So it becomes something like the opium den. This is what it looks like in operation. It worked better than any of us ever thought. We did a green room for them too, where they would actually shoot their interviews with people. But as soon as this part was completed, they did a couple of test shoots at the bar instead of in the green room. And it would inspire, let's say more interesting behavior and conversation in the we had actually one guest damaged the bar. They got up, they were drinking, and they got up and they danced on the bar, and you're not supposed to dance on this bar, and cracked it. Had to go in and fix that. So, but anyway, the point is, it worked better than we even thought, because now most of what they shoot actually is at the bar, and the green room kind of goes unused. We were going for a very overt and sensual, frankly, tactility with this bar. So the way it's shaped, you know, the typical bar goes in like that so that you have room for your knees. This one comes out so that when you stand at the bar, it is on, it basically hits your midsection and it's ribbed, and I think you get the point. There are also stuff to do with your hands. I think I have a drawing coming up where we put these kind of topological and material devices into the top of the bar. You'll see it in a minute. That you kind of massage, or we call them palming mounds, because you know you're sitting there at a bar, you need to do it with your hands and you can't smoke anymore. So that's there it is. So there's these little features and stuff that you kind of need. It's a semi-rigid bar, so you can actually push on it and it flexes. So you get like this massaging going on. And there's even more interesting things in a minute of what you can do with your hands. We built this. We fabricated it and built it all ourselves. They couldn't afford to pay to have it done outside. So this is the moment I was talking about. For me, anyway, the breakthrough moment that the literal use of hair is okay. Where this is completely accidental. Remember, we had always resisted using hair literally because we thought that was stupid, basically. But we worked so hard on this bar, and we thought that we felt like we had solved every technical problem, from lighting to coloration to the structure to nearly all of the seams, except for this one set of seams that recurs over and over, that we couldn't get to work. And the problem is that you really mustn't show an exposed edge in plastic unless it's machined. You really mustn't show it. It's not aesthetically good. It just looks bad. And there was this one set of seams as you wrap yourself around that you couldn't tuck in. Every other detail is a tuck-in detail, but there's one that you just couldn't get that to happen. And so finally, it's like an act of desperation. We took red fur and we jammed it in all those cracks, like all those areas where the seams were exposed, because then the fur kind of just obscures that rough edge. It came to be called the bikini detail, but it was basically a moment of discovery that came out of an act of desperation. This moment in this bar is by far the favorite moment for these clients and the people that go and visit the bar. So it worked far better than... This was, in our view at first, the weakest moment, and it became the strongest. So I didn't turn back after that. Of course, we're responsible for making proper details. So on the inside of the bar, we started, which is all hard industrial kind of black rubber, a working proper working surface where you can mix drinks and clean it and all of that stuff. We kept going with the fur in there, and there are these details where it's hidden, where it's not hidden, this like that. And so then we started using like body piercing. It's not really, it's actual hardware, but it looks like body piercing stuff to kind of go on with the theme and the mood. It was fun to do this stuff. And so then we did this as a surprise for our client, who's a strange guy and who loved all the fur stuff. And so he likes to take his clients and do this. And that's just like, he thinks we're brilliant geniuses because of that. All right, so Raspberry Fields is a more serious project. This is a renovation of a one-room Mormon schoolhouse that's in northern Utah. It's been in the client's family the client's family built it in 1912 or something like that. Anyway, she owns it. She wants to use it seasonally, just during the summers. She grew up there. In that culture, when she was growing up, little girls picked raspberries. It happens to be one of two or three places in the country where raspberries grow really, really well. They're great raspberries in this part of the country. And she has fond memories now of picking raspberries as a little girl. So she wants to grow raspberries, 10 acres of or 5 or so acres of raspberries on this 10-acre property and have a seasonal house to live in while she's doing that in her retirement years. So hence the name Raspberry Fields. This is the context. There's way more cows there than there are people. This is actually the property right now. So this is a very scary project for me. Because I'm also kind of close to the community up there. I didn't want to, and this building is one of the last remaining historical kind of registry buildings, or registry caliber buildings that you find up there. And it means a lot to that community. And I'm not one to be disrespectful necessarily, but I also didn't necessarily want to do a straight preservation project either. Anyway, it was a very complicated psychologically to how to deal with this. You know, how to balance preservation with projection, I guess. One of the first, so I started looking around at other people who may have been in the same problem. I started looking at Grant Wood's paintings and reading Grant Wood's kind of biography. And looking at the struggle between localism or regionalism and globalism. Because he was struggling, didn't know quite one foot in the regional and one foot in a much larger international understanding of art. Anyway, it seemed like that there was something analogous to some of his struggles with painting, with this struggle with this project for me. He's got these conflicting allegiances to both his own local heritage and character, the Iowa kind of heritage and character, as well as that of his larger artistic agenda, and that seems to force him into a position of cracking open the idiom of regionalism. In some sense, I felt like the notion of regionalism and contextualism, it can't be ignored in a project like this Raspberry Fields. Now, as I understand it, art historians have never been comfortable with the notion that Wood was a pure regionalist painter. There's something a little more than that. If anything, he practiced a kind of perverse regionalism. And I found this approach useful. I couldn't just tear the schoolhouse down. Could, but I wouldn't. But at the same time, I feel like it would be a form of impotence to simply do a straight restoration. And so I'm doing a restoration that's not all that straight. I also find this particular painting, as well as some of his landscape paintings, American Gothic, useful for its affective disposition, which happens to be very similar to that which I want to capture in the project, which is kind of slightly spooky, eerie, uncomfortably rigid, slightly dark and repressive, but at the same time a reaction against those qualities through humor and forced compositional posturing. Now with Wood's landscape paintings, which I also find useful, there's a more direct model for my own treatment of the landscape of the Raspberry Fields part of this project. They, I think, represent a kind of designerly wishful thinking about the landscape, portraying a perversely turgid or swollen agrarianism, a kind of amplified bucolic. And we try to replicate that here. The site is constructed in a kind of similar fashion to the Wood landscape, the Grant Wood landscapes. It's kind of slightly unnatural or pumped up. Maybe it's more natural than natural. This I just think is fun. Mills and plows. There's an image of a physical model we did finally for this show, Matters of Sensation, from two summers ago. Now, the shingles, I think I've got these misplaced, but anyway, here it is in context with some of my friend's work. The other reference that I looked at in trying to get my head around this project was Carlo Molino's very, very early work when he was even still a teenager, I think like 19 or something. Carlo Molino, this very strange, you guys know him, such a strange take on modernism. Fantastic work later on. But the early stuff, he went up into the mountains and he did these really exacting and wonderful, and a lot of them, drawings of these kind of regional this vernacular in the Alpine mountains of Italy, these log cabins, basically what would here be log cabins. He did tons and tons of it. He did it so well, he won an award for this stuff. And to my mind, I mean, I don't take from any of his stuff literally, I don't think, but what I like about it is a guy who is known to be so wild, and frankly off the deep end by some, I think, in other words, so projective, ultimately, is also has his other hand, let's say, in preservation. He's trying to preserve this stuff, at least in drawn form. Okay, so the way the house works, the original building is this. This is the original ground plan of the building. Basically, you can see it in the weathering. The side that's facing the storms looks like a 100-year-old schoolhouse that has barely been protected. And the other side, well, that's the other side up there, actually doesn't leak, it's in very good condition. And I'm interested in the fact that a thing of form that's bilaterally symmetrical is also not. Wandering around trying to figure out, we do have to reclad the building because the cladding on the one side is so wrecked, as you can see here. And one day the client and I were walking around and she said to me, isn't that beautiful, kind of romantic, isn't that beautiful the way that this wood curls so extreme? I mean, some of it's like literally curling 360. Is there any architectural cladding that could do that? So the idea then came for the shingle. We were thinking wood, we didn't know planks or shingles, and the curly shingle idea came from that. Originally, we're not doing this now, but originally we were thinking of like Ziggy played left hand, you know, playing the guitar wrong. We were thinking of orienting the grain the wrong way, thus hastening the weathering effect on the one side of the house, because as you can see, I've decided to actually try to handle that simply through species selection of the shingles and their dimension, their thinness, instead of orienting the grain the wrong way, because I'm afraid if we do that, it actually would break off quickly, which would be interesting, but anyway. The undersides of the shingle, we're gonna stain them colors. It happens to be, I don't think it really matters what colors, but for us, they're gonna correspond with the four species of raspberry that grow up there. There's an orange, a red, a purple, and a black. So we'll do orange, red, purple, and black, and it'll correspond with the planting plan of the field. But really all that matters is that there's color. And so over time, on the north side, on the south side, the part that will curl, you'll get a kind of growing flamboyance, growing flamboyance on a coloration that will emerge, kind of blushing. The northern side, the protected side, I anticipate will never curl at all. It'll just always be kind of straight. Some of the shingles will need to be custom bent, the ones that happen at key transitions. But the idea is that most of them would be allowed to deform stochastically, meaning we'll put them on either flat, or I may actually get it started by pre-bending them a little bit on the one side and then putting them on just so that the ice and the rain and the wind can get under them even from the first year. But the idea is that the bulk of the shingles, the ones in green, would just be allowed to curl naturally. I wouldn't control them. There are other weird spots, not that many, but over like window headers and so on, where we plan to design, like really custom bend the shingles in the same way that one might treat the bangs of the hairstyle. This is just the key plan for where the custom shingles go. Anywhere you see like colored hatching is custom shingle. Anywhere else is just the straight stochastically bent ones. This is the guy who does that stuff. He's up in State Line, Nevada. This guy developed this technique for curling shingles because he curls shingles, but he curls them the other way. We're curling them out. He does houses where the shingles are curled this way, and the reason for that is some clients of his, well, he's able to simulate thatched roofs. Thatched roofs are nearly impossible to build at this point, even in England and Ireland and Scotland, let alone in this country, because it's so labor intensive. They're remarkably expensive. And so he does these simulated like gingerbread things out of wood shingles that he's bent. This is the plan showing the two sides. This is the side that bears the brunt of stuff. That's the public side, and that's the raspberry field side. Here's sort of the way. This is a good image because it just, this is essentially the disposition of the building after a good number of years. This is where we want it to be. And the floor, basically, we've raised part of the floor on the first level such that it would align with the average top height of the plant, of the raspberry plants that grow out there. So you stand on that floor and they have the windows down to the floor, and you would look out across, your ground plane would essentially be the tops of these raspberry bushes. This is like a animation, see that? We were asked to do these digital models. The physical model is much, much better, I think, and much more satisfying. We were asked to do them when we were entered the project into that Matters of Sensation show. They needed like a proof of concept or something, and it had to be digital models or digital renderings, digitally derived renderings. So we made these renderings of the project, but it's such a strange thing to do when you're talking about naturally curling shingles. It took months for us to figure out how to get animation software to produce what looked like it hadn't been, well, produce something that looked stochastically deformed. The physical model is way easier to build and much more fun. We did it with curling irons and wood veneer. These are just some shots of the interior floor. Originally it would be lined with wood, but now we're thinking leather. And here's like the color. That's the obviously the weathered side. And that's it with the octopus. Now, want to see one or two more fast? I've gone 1 hour.
More.
Two more. All right, fast. They couldn't be more different. They're both, well, this one's done. This took 4 days. This is a project I just did with an office called Idea Office. They're long old friends of mine, Eric Kahn and Russell Thompson. They teach at SIRE. And we wanted to work together for a long, long, long time. So we just entered this little competition with a week to go, just for kind of fun. The idea, though, makes sense in the context of the work. What we did was, the brief calls for, it's a room for London, and it's a hotel room, single hotel room, that gets put on the Queen Elizabeth Hall, the roof of the Queen Elizabeth Hall in London. It's sort of near that eye thing, the big Ferris wheel. And the program is that of a single hotel room, so like a double bed, a sink, a bath, a toilet, a shower, and a reading space or writing space or something. That's really it. And it's meant to go in, be there for a year, and then be removed to some other site that they didn't specify. And it's not so much about making another hotel room in London, it's about the kind of spectacle of a hotel room on a rooftop. And therefore the character of the thing from the city clearly is more important, I guess, for the project than the functionality of the room inside. At least that's the position we took. And we also sort of, thinking back on like kind of what we think English people like, we think they like pneumatics. And so we decided, well, let's do pneumatic. We never did anything pneumatic before anyway, so we might as well try one. And so our take on the pneumatic was something to do with character, which ties back to kind of the Ziggy thing. We were not so interested, and we didn't think we had much to contribute, frankly, to the technology of pneumatic structures. But we did want to re-examine and maybe come up with something new in terms of what their character are, because they are kind of fantastic technological things. They also have a very particular character. It's just kind of unavoidable. And so we thought, well, why don't we just seize on that end of the problem of pneumatics as opposed to the other things that have been better explored by others. And so we decided to study the character of pneumatics, and our entry point was, what's the character of it when it's deflated, as opposed to when it's inflated? So we basically do this pneumatic structure that's being able to be intentionally deflated. You would occupy it a lot of the time when it was either partially or entirely deflated, as opposed to entirely inflated. It also happened to solve the weight issue for the roof and the mobility issue and all of that. So we could say we solved those problems, but really it was about the character of it, and what is wrinkled, clear plastic kind of look and feel like, both from outside and inside. So we made this kind of weird starfish-looking thing that where the innermost core is rigid, but the arms, basically, the idea would be if you let the air out of them, they just flop like a sleeve with no arm in it. And there's some argument about how that would correspond to program. But really, the more interesting, which is an interior argument as opposed to the exterior one, but really I think it's the exterior argument that's better, seeing this thing sometimes inflated, sometimes partially inflated, and sometimes fully deflated on the roof in London for a year. And so that was that project. We didn't win. And the last thing I could show, this couldn't be further in, but people that work for me have said, you should show things that actually you do to make money. Because you show starfish and stuff, and people think you're irresponsible or whatever. And so finally I decide, okay, I'll show something. Because I maybe can start to cobble together an argument for character. It's not complete, so don't get mad that this is a woefully inadequate or incomplete argument. But it is a project. It goes into construction in the next 2 or 3 months. It's in Minneapolis, and it's very, very modest. Modest budget, modest structure. It's a full gut renovation, nearly gut renovation of an existing post-war house in Minneapolis. The initial take, this is not where it went, but originally they've got a house. I didn't put the site plan in, I'm sorry, but they have a house and then there's a small garage. And the original idea before we got the bids back was, let's do a kind of roofscape that goes from the main house, because we have to replace the roof on the main house. It goes from the main house all the way across the yard and sits on top of the garage. So inevitably it becomes a topology project. And we did a bunch of studies, both digitally and physically, where how do you basically understand that roofscape as topology? And then how do you understand this topology? So this is where these kinds of drawings come from. Ultimately, and this is good even though it sounds bad, the client can't afford that. They can only afford, not only can they not afford that whole long roof, with the rest of the stuff that we're doing on the interior, the real guts of the project, they can't even afford the full kind of stuff of the roof on the main house if we're gonna do the guts of the project, which we are. So we had to really get modest really fast. That was sad at first, but actually I'm much happier now that it's forced the lens through which I'm looking at the project from something that I think we all know very well, which is this topology surface thing going across, to something much more difficult and frankly very modest, but something I'm trying to, the lens I'm trying to kind of refocus is toward character. We all know, I don't know if it's better or worse, but we think of windows as eyes into buildings or whatever. You hear this all the time. It's probably not a safe way to think about windows, but it's almost inevitable, at least in traditional houses, and this thing we're working on is a traditional house. So I started thinking, what about the dormer? Because basically what we're winding up doing is some dormers, at least the roof part of the project. And I was reading this thing Chuck Close said when he started painting the portraits, that they were, I may be badly phrasing this, but basically the idea was that the mugshot, the reason why he was doing this stuff that are like mugshots is because no matter how good your technique is, And no matter how accurately you depict the face, you cannot escape the character of the subject seeping out. And often, the character of the subject is seeping out through the eyes. But then I was reading further, in one of the paintings, I can't remember which one it is now, but he talks about, in this case, it's the eyelid that gives it away. And I was starting to think about eyelids and dormers, if windows are eyes and lids are dormers, and so that's where this comes from. I also love Night of the Hunter, and I always love the shots inside those dormers in that house. So we started doing this stuff with dormers. This is when the budget got cut and we want to get this thing built. So we started like the most minimal possible dormer you can make, and what happens if you like lean it over a little bit, maybe a nod to Raspberry Fields in the most modest of ways. Ultimately, we wound up getting to do that dormer there, which is that dormer there, but there's no longer that wall in. Anyway, it basically opens up the upper floor. This was another weird dormer. Basically, where the project goes now, and it's still on the board, so you're not seeing anything finalized. And here's how I'll end it. I'll compare it to Raspberry Fields. If the issue with Raspberry Fields was, one of the agendas was to, you've got this hard typological form, the pitched roof domestic kind of shape. One of the ways to sublimate that, should you want to, which I did and do, would be to cover it with a material that exuded such force or such effect that it's capable of, let's say, competing, if not totally sublimating, but competing with the typological form that's underneath it. In this case, what we came to after thinking about, like, well, what kind of materials could we wrap this one in? Could it be curly shingles, blah, 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 and all that? At the end of it, I thought, well, why not actually, maybe you can sublimate the form, not, maybe the answer isn't always by wrapping it in something that's spectacular, but rather by simply multiplying it. And so what we call the project now is the Dormer on the Dormer project. So we're doing, let me see if there's an image at the end. You can kind of see it, but basically, like the most recent version of it, and this is probably what we'll do, on the one side of the roof, I don't have images of the other side where there are other dormer characters, but the two, there's a big dormer, and then there's a little dormer coming out of the dormer, and then there's another dormer that's in some sort of a relationship with it. So, you know, this is it. I mean, basically, we're this is where it goes. After all of that, is two little dormers on the one that's kind of medium sized. I don't know. But I mean, the idea is that the problem is to make this thing interesting, we're trying to, however modest the project might be, get some care. Like right now, we're refocusing our attention on the idea of character in the architecture, and that's what's going on in the most latest everyday stuff in the office. And that's it.